So I just adjusted it from there.
Okay, thank you all for coming along to see my presentation. As you probably all know, I've been studying with CQU for a while now, and I've been doing prac for placement for the last few weeks. Part of that placement was doing a project about a quality improvement issue. I chose to look at the bench, how the bench logs in and sorts specimens. There we go. The project also called for giving a minute or two of background information about Sullivan Nicolaides before getting to the meat of the talk. So let's just get that out of the way, and I'll see if I can tie the two together. A little background. Sullivan Nicolaides was formed in 1956 when Dr. Sullivan started a small pathology servicing the local families in and around Brisbane. Dr. Nicolaides then joined him about 15 to 18 months later, and since then it's grown into one of the largest practices in Australia. In fact, it is the largest specialist pathology practice, becoming an international referral laboratory with more than 60 pathologists, a network of more than 20 laboratories, 300 collection centres, hundreds of scientists, thousands of staff, all serving doctors and their patients in the metropolitan Brisbane area, regional areas of Queensland, northern New South Wales, Northern Territory. You can see it's a massive area of more than 2 million square kilometres. The practice is managed by doctors for doctors. This is a pretty important concept for us. Our CEO is a pathologist, the department directors are all pathologists, and pathologists are represented at all levels of management. Doctors are always encouraged to communicate with our pathologists, and there is a liaison manager appointed to look after each medical practice, ensuring an individualised experience. Sullivan Nicolaides is one of the largest members of Sonic Healthcare Group. Sonic is a global healthcare company. It's Australian owned, located in Sydney, and a reputation for excellence in laboratory medicine and pathology services.
I'm sold.
Really? You want to join here? Okay, a little background. All the SMP labs are of the highest standard, fully accredited with the National Association of Testing Authorities, NATA, and also the Royal College of Pathologists of Australasia, RCPA. The core Sullivan Nicolaides laboratory services revolve around offering a wide range of tests, both routine and specialised. Many labs send us referral work because we offer tests that others just simply cannot. Our central lab operates 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, even an extra one on leap years. That was an easy one. Many of the tests we perform daily and results are available to the doctors the same day. This is a quote that I thought summed that up pretty well. Routine or complex, we take great pride in delivering the highest quality diagnostic services 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So, in early 2000, Sonic Healthcare planned a long weekend, a planning weekend was held. A team was set up to define and establish our core values. Thousands of people were consulted. After a number of draft versions, they came up with this document. To paraphrase the Sonic website, these values have been embraced enthusiastically and are the yardstick by which we measure our interactions with our colleagues and our customers and the performance of our various duties. You can read through these at your leisure or talk with Jack later. Jack has them memorized.
You were the coal face or whatever it was.
Yeah,
when you
front
were,
line guys.
Yeah,
in the trenches. Today I've decided to focus on the fourth one, which focuses about the improvement of ourselves and our processes. Which brings me back to the work improvement activity. So I tied that in nicely.
Well done, yeah.
Where's
that
Mike?
Michael kindly gave his permission to have his photo in this.
I didn't sign any documents, but
it'll come back to haunt you. Okay, the issue. Frozen specimens are being delivered to the wrong buckets in our freezer. This is after the samples have been through SRA and reached the sorting bench. So these samples are both logged in and not. I'm just trying to make a quick point that it's nobody else, this is definitely us. Okay, and it's not day staff, night staff, it's everyone. Okay, so why is this even an issue? Actually, let's start with something else. Let's start with why are some samples frozen and not others? It's all about stability. Freezing specimens stops metabolic processes. So the sample that is tested is close to the sample when it was taken from the patient. Some analytes are just more unstable than others. Calcitonin, gastrin, vitamin C, they all need to be handled carefully. Any degradation of sample integrity can give a false result. And we should keep in mind that doctors are using those results to treat and diagnose real people. Second point, not all the tests are performed every day. Lots of tests are performed only in batches on certain days. Many are done only 2 and 3 times a week. Some are only done once a week. Mesomark at the moment is done once every second or third week, depending if we have specimens for it. And then there are some samples that just require special conditions. I was talking with Karen the other day while I was having a fantastic time in endo. And she was telling me that the histamine procedure required a freezing step in the testing. Another example is renin. It can't be refrigerated because at 2 to 8 degrees, prorenin, the precursor to renin, converts to renin and gives a falsely elevated result. That was just in case the doctors were here.
It's got other people
like. Okay, something else to watch for. Repeated freeze and thaw cycles can also degrade the sample. From the androstenedione manual, it states that repeated freezing and thawing of the sample may decrease the androstenedione level. Which brings us back to the issue. Samples ending up in the wrong bucket. I mean, they're in the freezer, so is this really an issue? They are frozen, they're not degrading. They'll get found eventually. If Paula was here, you would see the redness in her face just climb higher and higher. But we can ask Karen. She was with Paula last Friday. Karen, how much time did you spend looking for that calcitonin? Yeah. Easily an hour?
Yeah.
Oh, you were with her. Sorry, I thought it was Karen. Everyone.
2 hours.
2 hours.
Two
there
of
we
us
go.
Were
it's getting worse. Calcitonin, who was logged in on the Tuesday and then just gone missing. The TA staff have been keeping a log on how many specimens they find in the wrong buckets in the morning.
4 hours.
Yeah, I think we've still got one to share there. Been keeping a tally of the specimens that they find in the wrong buckets in the morning when they're doing their prep work. That in 5 days they found over 50 specimens in the wrong buckets. Each of those could have potentially been like that calcitonin requiring an hour to find. But even if it's only a couple of minutes, it's a couple of minutes times 50. And again, both day and night staff are contributing to this. The sample will also miss that first available test run. I mentioned androstenedione before. Let's take that as an example. It's tested on Tuesdays and Fridays. If it comes in on a Wednesday and it gets put in the wrong bucket, we don't find it for the Friday run, it won't get tested until the next Tuesday. That's almost a week after the patient's been collected, and the doctor really should have been expecting the results by that weekend rather than the next week. There's also a lot of temptation on the TA to recollect that sample because it's a Friday. They will be thinking, it hasn't turned up, maybe it's missing. If I don't recollect it now, it'll be Monday till I do that, Tuesday before the patient gets recollected, Friday again, all of a sudden we're 2 weeks later. So it does become a problem. Carry away. again, possibly degradating the specimen. There's been plenty of occasions where calcitonins and gastrins have ended up in a SOM bucket, being defrosted for the SOM run, which they don't have it on the request form, and then the sample is no good for their actual test. Which brings us to recollects. We're recollecting actual lost specimens, but we're also recollecting specimens that are lost but still in the lab, like the androstenedione I was talking about. And then there's also samples that just can't be recollected. First trimesters, there's only a narrow window during a pregnancy that that can be collected. If you're already up against that window, by the time a recollection happens, it's just going to be too late. So, what is the current process? In the batch bench manual, frozen section 5.4.3, I won't go into it because it is a couple of pages long, but as you'd expect, it pretty well spells out exactly what to do. It deals with checking identifications, how to log it in, what to check for on particular tests, how to deal with multiple tests on a single tube, troubleshooting, and stresses. It's in all caps, always put it in the right bucket. There's also Jody's golden rules for being a batch bench wizard. That sounds pretty good.
Is it a Rudio footer? It is signed today.
Well, yeah, that's Jody's signature. I'm not sure if it's Rudio. And again, it tells you to log everything in. You can see it's got five rules there. Log everything in. Sort specimens alphabetically, and that works for the example given of ACTH and aldo-renin, but if it was something like an OPG and a thigh, that doesn't actually work out to be the best way to do things. But even if it was done alphabetically, I'd be pretty happy with that, because then we'd know where to look for the specimen. Anyway, more on that later. Don't defrost anything that comes in frozen. If it is frozen, keep it frozen, and only log in the tests that you have. Not with frozen samples, not all tests come in at the same time, so you don't want to log in something that you don't have, because then when it comes to the TA looking for that sample, they'll see that there's a tracking event that you've received it, and as far as they're concerned, it's not in the bucket, it's gone missing, so we might recollect the sample that hasn't even arrived yet. And five again, stresses, put it in the right place, please put it in the right place, and some extra notes. So, what else can be done? I went around and asked some of the staff for suggestions. I spoke with Karen Lau. She thought that maybe if we watch people a little. Maybe they'd pay more attention to what they were doing. Karen Young, on the other hand, thought that perhaps if there was some sort of personal repercussion. People might pay more attention. When I spoke to Paula, I think it's best she's not here. And actually, I spoke to Beck as well. Beck, for some reason, was fixated on a Yeti scaring everyone who got it wrong. Beck, I'm sorry, there are no scary Yetis. Anyway, so I took all of this into it. I took all of this into consideration, thought about what do they really mean when they're telling me these things? What's the underlying message? And I thought about it for a while, and it came to me, they're talking about education. In very different ways, but still education. Okay. Primarily, I thought that if people understood why samples were frozen and the principles behind the sorting process, then some of these problems could be avoided. So I'm talking about the frozen specimen sorting order. And what is that? It's based on the minimum number of thaw freezing cycles to preserve the specimen stability. Okay. And for that education, I've built up a web-based app. So, in looking at the problem, I noticed there are different rules, and some of you know I've dabbled in web design, app design, that sort of stuff, and when I saw these rules, I realized that computers are just fantastic at handling rules. You just plug them in, and as long as they're right, it will just apply them, and you don't have to think about it any further. So I built this according to those rules. And I've asked Aaron to come forward and drive it for me while I take you through it.
Aaron.
Okay,
so we'll just go through some of the functions.
Its core function is that the bench staff can simply click on whatever tests are requested, and in this output screen here will come up the priority, and that's the bucket that you put it in. So, Aaron, we'll start with something really simple, the thigh and the OPG that I mentioned before. OPG's up the top.
Yeah, there we go.
Yep. So you can see, even though the OPG is alphabetically before the thigh, it's actually the thigh that you want to put it in. Okay, and that's to do with how often the tests are run. I think the thigh is done on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, whereas the OPG is done every day. So if it's Tuesday, we don't want to thaw it for the OPG, we'll wait till the Wednesday, and then both tests can be done on the same day with only one thaw cycle. But if we were to add a calcitonin to that, Aaron. I did ask you a couple of times during the week to have a play with it.
It's John Travolta.
I'm the Yeti.
So as you can see, as soon as we add the calcitonin into it, it jumps to the front of the queue, and that's where you want to put it. So if it was in the calcitonin bucket, they only get tested on Mondays. Thigh gets tested on Mondays as well, OPG every day. So all of those tests get done with a single thaw cycle. Okay, just reset that, Aaron. Graham. So I've got a bunch of highlighting options down the side. So this is if you had a tube in your hand, weren't really sure what tests could be done on that. This can just give you a hint. Aaron, if you click one of them. So serum, you can see lots of tests require a serum. And this is the expected tube type. They also have alternate tubes, but we'll talk about those in a minute. So this is the primary expected one. If it was an EDTA, you don't need to click them off. There's only two that are done on EDTA. Lithep, there's three. PBT, no. Foiled. This one's a little hard to see, but it's there. And urines. And if you wanted to see the testing priority, you noticed earlier that these colours came up. The green is tested every day. Yellow, high priority, which means it's not tested every day. And the red is critical because it needs to be treated in a special way. And usually that means it comes in frozen and stays frozen until it's tested. Okay, click that off. And the info buttons. So each of the tests, you can click on an info button, doesn't matter which one. And you can see it comes up with its proper name, some alternate names that you might see it by, the expected tube type. If it does have an alternate tube type, that'll come up as well. Transport. The transport statement is geared towards the bench staff. So they're not troubleshooting whether it can be run or anything like that. It's what they should be doing with their job. So some things can arrive at room temp, but freeze them as soon as possible. There's various versions of that statement. And it tells you when it's run, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and which department and where I can, what machine. So if you did have a question to ask about that particular thing, you can go and see the person who's running it that day. And click on the calcitonin one. Aaron, click the calcitonin info. And you can see that it comes up with a warning at the top saying it should arrive frozen, stay frozen. So a number of them have those warning signs as well. Okay, just get rid of that, Aaron. So what I didn't tell Aaron,
where this was going,
was that he was going to run some live ones. So he hasn't seen these before. And these are all samples that I went through the freezer yesterday and found in the wrong bucket. And that's after Heidi and Paula had been through and found 11, I think it was, yesterday morning in the wrong buckets. I came back and checked at around 12 and found these ones. Now that doesn't mean that they were all done by yesterday's day staff. They could have been buckets that weren't tested that day, so it could have been from anywhere from the night before. Okay, Aaron, looking forward to this, aren't you?
Yeah.
Let's find example two first. I've started on number two because it's a nice, easy one. Okay, so example two, in Apollo, had an androstenedione and an OHP. It had one serum aliquot. Aaron, we probably don't even need to put this one in. Who wants to have a go at it? Where should we go? Chris?
A and D.
Michael?
A and D.
Anyone else?
I agree.
Everyone agrees? A and D?
Yeah.
Go on, throw it in. A and D is right. And of course, I found it in the OPG bucket. Okay, let's go to number one. So what have you got there, Aaron?
So we got serum, what the hell, there's no markers on it, okay. You've just got a bunch of three serums and a lithium heparin sample.
Okay, and on that one? Plasma, okay. Nephrines, calcitonin, IGF. These are also in the order that Apollo gives them. So what would you do there, Aaron?
Well, looks like we got lithium heparin for our plasma, metnephrines, and then we've got three samples for calcitonin and IGF. So serum, calcitonin, sure, medium frozen. So we've got one for the IGF, one for the somatomedin, and the calcitonin would have two.
Do you want to plug it into the app?
No. Let's see. What have we got? We've got serums and lithium heparin. It only does one at a time, doesn't it? So that's for the serums. So we get calcitonin and somatomedin.
There we go.
We don't need that, do we? And then we have metnephrines, PMETs.
Still have a
lot. You want to do this?
Okay, yeah. And now you can see this time it comes up that the serum has calcitonin and SOM, and you need a lift hep for the plasma metnephrines. So what Aaron said earlier was right. You would put two to the calcitonin, put another tube in with the SOM, and let it rerun while the calcitonin sits in its bucket, and the PMX would be run on the lith head. What actually happened was it was logged in for calcitonin. Heidi found three banded tubes in the SOM bucket, which is a bit of a red flag in itself. So Heidi had a look at it, saw that there was a calcitonin. They weren't defrosted, so she put two tubes in the calcitonin, sent one on for the SOM to be run, and then later that day, when I went through the buckets, I found the lithep in the calcitonin bucket. So, again. Okay, this is fun.
You love to work in
the bathroom.
I did, but it wasn't much use for it.
You can almost even go a step further and put barcodes on the bucket so that you can.
Oh, we have all sorts of ideas.
And it would buzz or tell you if you're putting stuff in the wrong bucket.
You get electrocuted.
Well, there's lots of things you
can
do.
I can see Beck still wants the idea.
Just set up an electrical chair that goes off.
Okay. Example three. So just the two aliquots. Great. So these were unbanded aliquots. And they have a growth hormone, IGF-1, and insulin antibodies.
Alright, so we've got the...
Just put it in. Anyone want to have a guess at where it goes first? They're all serum.
Would you say you had two?
Two, but they were separate.
Oh, so they were separate?
Yeah, so it only got handled one at a time.
Well, usually the SOM is item attached to the growth hormone. That should have gone in the growth hormone bucket. And then the insulin antibodies, if that was separate, should have gone in the insulin antibodies.
Okay. So you can see, if they're coming in separate, so you only got a single tube, the insulin antibody would be the place to put it.
Mm.
You agree with that, Heidi?
Yeah.
Yeah. If they were banded together, then what Heidi's saying is right. You would separate them and put one in the insulin antibody and one in the growth hormone.
Mm.
And some can get done off the growth hormone.
But if there's, yeah, it should have an aliquot, empty aliquot with it, though, for the SOM.
There we go. What actually happened? So the tubes are separated. found, well, sorry, one tube was logged in for insulin antibody, which is good, that's what should happen. An empty aliquot tube was banded to it, which is fantastic, because as Heidi said, that indicates that there are other tests for that sample where it'll need to get passed on to. But then it was put in the growth hormone bucket. And the second tube, which wasn't logged in, somehow also ended up in the growth hormone bucket. So I'm not sure how that worked out. Okay, we're moving on to four. Four's the big one.
You got the whole shebang.
Just put it all in the gas room.
Yeah. Alright, so just plug them all in?
Just plug it in.
Yes, please.
For some reason these pages won't separate. Here we go. Okay. This one's got PMET, chromogranin, calcitonin, SOM, ACTH, aldo-renin, gastrin. Three serum aliquots, one Lisdap, PPT. So, just so one of the features is with the PPTs, when you're putting in both tests, there are rules about how to split them up. So automatically, when Aaron's put in both tests, it's come up with a splitting rule. So Aaron, how many PPT tubes do you have?
One.
So what would you do?
Place in the ACTH bucket, banded aliquot tube marked aldo-renin.
Excellent. Okay, click that off. Is that everything?
Renin to go as well.
So have you got everything?
I think so. No. Gastrin.
There we go. Okay, so as you can see, the order would be the calcitonin. If you only had a single serum, calcitonin would take priority. Lithep is easy with the PMAT, and ACTH and aldo-renin, as Aaron said, get put in the ACTH bucket. Now, how many serums do you have?
Got three serums.
So what would you do with those?
So we got one to go to calcitonin, one to go to gastrin, and then one for the SOM and the
chrome. Cool. Okay, what I would actually do is put two in the calcitonin and one in the chromogranin. Because the SOM can get tested off the chromogranin, and by putting it in the calcitonin bucket, gastrin and calcitonin get tested on the same day, so they would just get passed to each other. Fantastic. Aaron, give Aaron a hand. Come on. Documentation to go along with that, and that part of the paperwork on that might be something like what we just did in that demo. We'd have to answer a series of questions after putting them through it. Okay, there's also a poster that I've made to summarise the priority rules that web app was based on. So with this, it just summarises, as I said, the critical tests at the top, they have to come in frozen and stay frozen. These ones are the ones that are not tested every day, so they take priority over other ones, and everything else can be sorted alphabetically with the proviso, first trimesters first, SOMs last. And then it just quickly goes through the ACTH aldo-renin splitting rules again. And I'd also like to introduce a frozen problem test set and problem buckets in the freezer and fridge. This is when you have a sample, it won't log in, you don't know where to go. Rather than just taking a guess and throwing it in a bucket that could be wrong, if while at the bench you log in, you add on this frozen problem test set, you can fill it in, and what that does, I'll just go to the next one. So you can fill it in, you can see the only two lines that are mandatory are how it arrived and where you've put it. If you want to fill the rest in, that's fine. But those are the main two that I actually want, because that way we know how it came in and where it should be. Please put it in the bucket, so you put it in. Next one. And the great thing about that is that it would give us a tracking event between SRA and the buckets. So when the TA is looking for it, they will be able to see, yes, it has actually hit the bench. We don't need to go and look at SRA for where it is. The TA can also do a pending list straight up in the morning, so they would see if there were any problems from the day before that need to be dealt with, or as they progress through their work and they came across a name that was missing off one of their pending lists, they can look at that and say, it's in the bucket. Put it in the bucket, say put it in. We have a known sample location because you filled that in and said, I'll put it in the frozen problem bucket in the freezer. And the fourth thing, which is fantastic, it allows us to follow up with the person who logged that, and we can then take to them the resolution of that problem, and if they see it again in the future, they might be able to handle it a little bit better. Which allows us to be, from the fourth value, enthusiastic about continuous improvement of ourselves and our processes, and learn to live. You like that one?
Yeah, it's great.
Okay, again, there will be some documentation to go with that. Okay, to summarize. The issue we had was frozen problems ending up in the wrong bucket. It causes lost time, delayed results, degraded specimens, and recollections. Nobody wants that. The solution is education about the rules of the frozen test priority. And to achieve that, I've come up with a frozen sort of web app, which is fantastic, if I don't mind saying. the priority rules poster, which summarizes the rules that was all built on, and then the frozen problem test set. Thank you. The time frame for implementation on any of these, the web app is pretty well ready now, the poster is obviously ready now, and the test set might require a month or so between the time we decide if we want to implement it and actually putting it into what use. So at the end of all of that, hopefully it'll be a little bit easier for everyone to do the right thing. Thank you. Any questions at all?
Where can we start?
Thank you. Just quickly, it's more there. There are scary days.
I'd like to see it so it could link in with the, this is big picture, the TCM and other tools that we have.
Yeah.
And from a control perspective, if something changes, like the day that Karen's testing changes, or that it can be real time, it'd be, I mean, obviously you've got to start somewhere, but it's got a lot of potential.
Yeah, that obviously requires integrating with Apollo, which I can't do by myself. But this might be something that can be shown to them and asked if they can integrate something like that into our current system.
But it highlights the complication of that bench and all the decisions that have been made.
That's why I included that fourth example, because even though it was done correctly, you can see that it can be quite complicated. And I've got to say, that was really well done. Those didn't all come in on the same day, so it was multiple people across multiple days logging that in. So it was really well done.
Oh, I'm impressed. It's been fun. I've tried using it, but there hasn't been a lot of multiple ones to use it on.
Did you have fun just then?
No.
You were nervous. Aaron, you'd do it wrong.
I can do everything wrong, don't worry about it.
I'm pretty sure everyone else enjoys watching.
That's why you picked me.
How does that process link in with actually logging it into Apollo? Is it being, when people are using it, are they doing it consecutively? Would you need two screens?
Two screens would be ideal. The way Aaron's had it is Apollo on half the screen and this on the other half.
Okay, not great, but.
Where I see this really coming to its own.
Splitting in here.
Scared me for a second. is with new people. So when new people come to learn the bench, they'll be able to use this because it's a lot of information to hold in your head. So if they can use something where like that as a training aid, I think that would be very helpful. And that's why I developed the poster as well, because people who aren't here are less likely to open the entire app and go through it, but they might just need a quick reference. If I can look on it over there, see what needs to come in frozen and stay frozen.
Keeps it know, because, you know, different people have different ways of doing things. Mm. It's not always the right way.
The only thing that I remember being an issue is when we receive two separate samples separately. Like, sometimes we'll get the lithium heparin tube and the plasma will come in
later,
an hour later.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing that stuffs that whole system up, because you're going, well, what am I supposed to do? You know, like, yeah, it's just...
Well, and if you, like, for vitamin C's, I find that's what we get a lot, is
yeah.
the actual tip off.
Like
yep. the actual PTF, and then they'll send that when it's been frozen.
Yeah.
But if you get that, just put an episode note in saying only with HEP received.
Yeah,
MDR quad tube and to as a visual
yeah.
indication.
Or something like that, just
yeah.
so we
yeah.
know we didn't receive the plasma.
Mm. But it's not just for that sort of thing, there's multiple
yeah.
times when that happens as well.
But as Jane pointed out, we could have that test set and the problem bucket.
Yeah. Also had that with PPTs and the ACHs and other rounds coming in separately and stuffing and going, oh, what have I got? I've only got the one.
Mm.
And assuming that you've only got the one.
There are various complications on the bench.
Mm.
Yeah. It's not an easy job.
No.
Do you have any assays that can't be frozen in other areas? Like, I don't know, one can all be frozen if
they're down.
Methotrexate. Yes, the blood syrup. No, hang on.
Porphyrins, we can't.
Porphyrin, there we go, yeah.
Anytime you want to make sure you've got whole blood, not
get
fluoride.
Yeah, that's a good example. Red cell,
folate.
Yeah, I don't think we really
suffer from that problem very much, though.
It's more the other way.
Mm.
The stuff comes in on
for us. Mm. Just getting in the right bucket sometimes, I think.
Very good. Thank you very much,
yeah,
everyone.
Thanks, Ben.
It's been great. I know a lot of people are finishing it too, so if they want
to... It's all right. We'll just charge it to the...
There's chocolate to make up for it, okay?
Anyone finishing it too?